Welcome back. It's episode 6 of Toying with History, and today we turn our attention to the Civil War and the bloodiest single day of that conflict, the Battle of Antietam. The battle itself is fought September 17, 1862. It comes about as Confederate General Robert E. Lee moves his roughly 45,000 Confederate troops north out of Virginia into Maryland to provide them with new foraging grounds, get the war out of his home state, and hopefully win a decisive victory in what was then a neutral state. That would be significant because it may convince Maryland to join the Confederacy, completely surrounding the capital. It may also encourage foreign nations to join the Confederate cause. Lee's campaign into Maryland gets off to a rough start when one of his officers loses his orders for the entire Maryland campaign. These orders fall into the hands of Union soldiers who take them up the chain of command, so Union generals, specifically George McClellan, are aware of everything Lee and his army plan to do while in Maryland. On the Union side, General George McClellan is calling the shot. McClellan is known to his troops as Little Mac and is loved by his troops, but sometimes loathed by Washington politicians, especially Abraham Lincoln. He is known for being overly cautious to the point of being paranoid and often greatly overestimates the strength of his enemy. In this case, McClellan had 87,000 troops available at Antietam compared to Lee's 45,000, yet consistently worried he was outnumbered despite having General Lee's orders in his possession from the start of the campaign. On September 17, 1862, the fighting began right at dawn at approximately 6 a.m. The battle worked from north to south on the battlefield, which is right to left on your screen. The initial action took place in what was one of the hottest spots of the entire war, known as the Bloody Cornfield. When we take a look at that section, you'll see Union troops making the initial attack, and then we'll see that piece of land traded back and forth over several hours. In the late morning hours, the battle moved to a portion of the battlefield known as the Sunken Lane, with the Confederates defending that position. We'll see Union attacks in that area of the battlefield that will last for approximately 2 hours from 10 a.m. to noon. Finally, in the afternoon, the action turned to the southern portion of the battlefield on the Antietam Creek and a bridge that would forever become known as Burnside's Bridge. You'll see a Union attack there, featuring that bridge against some Georgian snipers on the hills around it. The bloodiest single day of the war may have its most curious trait behind the front lines, and it would be all of these Union reserve soldiers who, despite being fresh, ready, and available for action, were not employed by General McClellan on this day. The fighting begins at first light as those first waves of Union troops head through Miller's Cornfield with their objective to rally at a small church on the other side of the battlefield known as the Dunker Church. The myth is that these troops somehow snuck through corn that was taller than them. However, scientific studies have proven that 1862 was a drought year and that corn did not grow as tall in that time period because we did not have the scientific engineering we use today. So that fact is probably false. These Union soldiers would have been met rather promptly by the men of Stonewall Jackson, among others, in that part of the battlefield, who would have pushed them right back out of the cornfield as the two sides continued to trade that piece of land back and forth throughout the morning. Wave after wave of soldiers poured into this portion of the battlefield as it became basically a gunfight in the open. Soldiers in this part of the battlefield had very little cover. They were in the open and shooting in very close proximity. After 3 hours of being led like pigs to slaughter into the cornfield, troops from both sides were completely exhausted. They had exchanged the cornfield back and forth over that period of time with no one side gaining a clear advantage. One group of Union soldiers had met their objective of reaching the Dunker Church, however, they were unable to sustain that position. With 5,000 casualties in that time frame, both sides were exhausted, and fighting here died out as it moved to the center of the battlefield. As action in the cornfield dies down and the day moves into late morning, Union troops in the center of the battlefield are on the move. They are slowly crossing a long, gently rolling piece of land that is probably covered by bean crops. And they know Confederates are in front of them, but because of the upslope, they can't tell exactly where the Confederates are. When those Union soldiers finally get to the top of that gentle hill, they will very quickly find themselves in close proximity to previously concealed Confederate soldiers. They will see a sea of Confederate soldiers, dead or alive, stationed in a sunken farm lane that will forever become known as the Bloody Lane. The Confederates at the sunken lane would have been extremely difficult to move. Part of this is because they were commanded by James Longstreet, who was the South's best defensive general. The position was strong, and most Union soldiers failed in their endeavor to move those Confederates in front of them. However, one group that had the most success was the Irish Brigade. I hate to keep harping on these guys, but they were a pretty remarkable unit. We know they succeeded in part because of their bullet technology. The Irish preferred a buck and ball, kind of like a buckshot in modern terms, as opposed to the Minier bullet. This allowed them to be very effective in close quarters. It was also their tenacity and the fact that they did not scare easily. They were disciplined in the face of the worst conditions the Civil War had to offer. The Irish in this particular part of the battlefield begged the question, what is a flag worth? During their charge at the sunken lane, 8 consecutive color bearers were shot down carrying this flag. How many of us today would sacrifice our life for a flag, as those 8 did, one after another? By noon, the action at the sunken lane has died down. It was said that in that portion of the battlefield, you could not have walked anywhere on that farm lane without stepping on the body of a dead or wounded soldier. It was that much carnage. The final phase of the Battle of Antietam plays out in the afternoon on the southern end of the battlefield on the shores of the Antietam Creek. On that end of the battlefield, there was a bridge. After the battle, it would forever be known as Burnside's Bridge because the Union commander in this portion of the battlefield was Ambrose Burnside. He was told to take the bridge to try to attack the left side of the Confederate Army. The Union had already tried and failed the right side, the center, and now it would be the left. The whole thing turned into basically one big turkey shoot, though. As 12,000 Union soldiers tried to cross this bridge, they were greeted by 400 Georgians perched on the hills on the other side. From their vantage point there, the Georgians could easily pick off the far superior Union numbers who had to funnel in across the narrow bridge. Burnside's Bridge was essentially a revolving door. For hours, Union troops would go onto that bridge, be shot to pieces by the Georgians on the hills, and retreat. And then a new group would go onto the bridge, be shot to pieces by the Georgians, and repeat. And this scenario played out for quite some time until finally, late in the afternoon, there was a break. The Georgians had to retreat from their position, and the Union was able to cross the bridge and turn the flank of the Confederate Army. With Lee and the Confederate Army now on the run, McClellan has an opportunity to score a massive victory and perhaps even end the war if he can cut Lee off from Virginia. However, McClellan opts not to utilize the reserve troops that he has fresh and ready to go, and instead, once he meets resistance from a late arriving AP Hill and Confederate reinforcements, he chooses to abandon the fight. September 17, 1862, Sharpsburg, Maryland, the Battle of Antietam goes down as the bloodiest single day of the war, with nearly 23,000 combined casualties. Despite all of the loss, it stacks up as a day of missed opportunities more than anything. It was an opportunity for the North to perhaps crush the South once and for all. However, the reluctance to pursue the Southern Army in the wake of the breakthrough on the left side probably cost them that. Once again, General George McClellan's cautious nature allowed Robert E. Lee to escape into Virginia and prolong a war that would last another 3 years. It was the closest thing Lincoln had had to a victory in a while. It did allow him to issue the Emancipation Proclamation. However, it would be years before any meaningful action came out of that symbolic gesture. We're not the same, we're different.